Hello everyone, I'm Michael Rubano, lead engineer of the Chicago Audio Collective, and I thought I would show you some of the work that's been done to this Gibson GA-20T amplifier. So let's take a look inside. The amplifier is built up on a circuit card, which comprises the preamplifier and tremolo circuits. The components are mounted on both sides, and it's set up on standoffs like this. The original capacitors, most of them are mounted on the other side, have been replaced with these modern replacements. These capacitors use a plastic dielectric. The originals used a paper dielectric, which at this point is over 50 years old and is completely no longer viable. And I actually took the time to test the original capacitors, and they had all failed. So had I tried to reuse them, the amplifier simply would not have worked. So all the capacitors have been replaced. All of the resistors have been tested. And after a burn-in, these two resistors here failed, so they have been replaced. In addition to that, over here, we have the power amplifier and power supply section, and a lot of work has been done here. Over here, we had the location of the original cardboard capacitors that we saw in the other video. They are not original, and I was able to determine that because when I attempted to remove them and I laid the soldering iron on the terminals, the wires fell away immediately. They were not attached properly, so those are not original parts. What I have done here is, of course, use modern parts, but I've set them off on these vertical tag boards and wired them into the circuit with insulated wire. This keeps them out of the heat and keeps them in a safe position, so there's no chance of them bumping into each other or anything like that as the amp gets moved around. Additionally, this is the cathode resistor for the output section. The original was a very old type that had sort of a cement coating that was very sandy and it was leaving bits behind. And it was also not original because its wires were attached to the wires of the original that had been clipped out, and they were not insulated. So this one is installed on the tag board. It's wired into the circuit with insulation, so it's out of the way of heat, and the heat that it generates will drift away and hopefully prolong the life of this amplifier. In addition to all of that work, we cleaned all the controls. I had to fit all new tubes. The originals were completely dead, including a matched set of 6V6 output tubes and a rectifier. In the other video, we mentioned the output transformer and that it was miswired. I can tell that it's not original because the mounting ears don't fit properly onto the original holes of the speaker. They were re-drilled and the wires were spliced. But this time, they're spliced correctly, and we used heat shrinkable tubing, so there's no chance of shock or short circuit or anything like that. In addition to that, we have a new tremolo cord on our nice tremolo switch. The original switch was able to be retained. I just cleaned it, reinstalled it, wired it up, and it sounds great and works great, and we're all set for lots of years of use. And the last thing we did was we replaced the original power cord with this new grounded replacement, and it's fastened in place very firmly, can't pull out. Like I say, it's grounded for safety. So this amplifier sounds great, works great, and is safe to operate for many years to come. In the before video, we said a few words about the condition of the cabinet, which in itself is sound, but of course the covering is in pretty bad shape. The owner of this amplifier asked me to leave the cover as it is, so we're not going to replace it.
Hi, I'm Gary Gand. We're here at Gand Music, and I'm going to show you what this little Gibson amp will do. I'm going to use a fairly stock Stratocaster. This is called a Fender Standard Stratocaster, just for you Strat folks out there so you know what the amp is doing. I'm not using exotic pickups or anything, you know, it's just your run-of-the-mill everyday Strat. Now, one of the things that's fascinating about this amp is it has a very interesting overtone series, and this is back in the day when there were no distortion pedals and there was no rock and roll. So distortion, although we learned to love it and it became the sound of our generation, at the time it was a bad thing. So I'm going to start with the guitar down just a little bit, get you a clean sound. And that's on the neck pickup. So you can see, very crisp, you know, bright kind of a sound. Back in the day, generally most amps were trying to get a mellow sound because guys were playing jazz and they were playing big box guitars. But by the time this amp became in the mainstream, the solid body guitar was coming on the scene, and guys were looking for a little crispier sound. If I go to the Layla position here between pickups one and two. You can see it's got a nice kind of a snarl to it. Bridge pickup. Now, no reverb in this, so it's not really a surf tone. But you can start to get a little hint of there's something going on that's kind of unique about the distortion of this amp. And what it's producing is it's producing an overtone that's about an octave above what I'm playing. You can hear a hint of it there. If I go to the neck pickup and I crank the guitar back up, and you may want to back it down there, you okay? You can hear that overtone sound, which is reminiscent of our great guitar hero from Seattle, who... which is just... sound. And we're going to cut here. I'm going to change to the microphone input on here where you get even more of that and you're really in for a treat. We've switched to a different input on the amplifier. As is always the case with rock and roll, hooking up to the wrong input or the wrong amp with the wrong instrument gives you the holy grail of sounds. You know, the famous one, of course, is all of us guys that started playing through basement amplifiers, which we stole from the bass player because he was too loud, and that's, you know, one of the greatest guitar amps of all time. So what we're doing here is we're plugging into the microphone input, and that has a pentode preamp. It's a completely different preamp than what I was playing through before, and it's similar to a Vox AC30. And you'll hear the gain goes way up, and that octave effect I was talking about earlier goes way up, and it's just great. So that's great. And then when you back down off of that, you can still get a real clean sound out of it. But that. And I mean, that's worth the price of the amp right there. One of the features of these early amps is something called tremolo. A lot of people call it vibrato. Tremolo is the ability for the volume of the amp to go up and down, as if you're running your volume control up and down. Vibrato technically would be a pitch change, which some of the later amps do have, like the magnetones, for example. But this particular amp has tremolo. There were lots of different ways to create that tremolo, but let me just let you hear what it sounds like. You can hear that undulating sound. And that was one of the earliest special effects, and there's a lot of things you can do with that. A lot of the swamp rock that people listen to is. That kind of sound. You can vary the rate of it and you can vary the depth of it so it can get faster. You can hear it speed up there. And you can also vary the depth of it to where it's actually almost shutting the sound off. I'll slow it down with the heavy depth and I can hear. Depth down so you get more of the original signal. I And there you have it.